Well, good morning and welcome to the Greater Miami Chamber of Commerce to our first Sea Level Rise Solutions Conference hosted by the Sustainability, Environment, and Energy Committee and in partnership with FIU's Sea Level Rise Solutions Center and Miami-Dade County's Office of Resilience. My name is Irela Baguet and I am the proud chair of the Sustainability, Environment, and Energy Committee. And for the past 4 years, the committee has dedicated part of its agenda to educate the business community on the issues of climate change and sea level rise when it wasn't very popular. We've heard from scientists, policymakers, local governments, planners, engineers, the insurance industry, and now we know irrefutably that the science is quite clear. The sea levels are rising. So South Florida has a responsibility to plan and become more resilient, not just for sea level rise, which is something that people think is way, way far away, but for storms, for the impending storm that may come, who knows, next hurricane season, God forbid, but it's a possibility. So in keeping with that theme, we decided to put this event on today, and we are thrilled at the turnout, at the support that we've received from the community at large. But before we get started, I want to call Ms. Christine Barney, the chair of the Greater Miami Chamber of Commerce, our fearless leader, and Mr. Wayne Pathman, the chair-elect of the Miami Beach Chamber of Commerce, for a few welcoming remarks, brief welcoming remarks.
Thank you, Irela. The Greater Miami Chamber of Commerce is the voice of business in South Florida. We represent more than 400,000 employees and member companies. And I also want to welcome you to what is probably one of the most important programs that we have for the year, focusing, as Irela said, on sea level rise. Since Miami has been labeled ground zero, or I think sometimes we've labeled ourselves that in some ways, in media stories around the globe for the last few years, we certainly are excited about being a leader in the topic on this topic. And what we say here is important because we are really at the intersection of business and community, and as the eighth largest metropolitan community in the U.S., we have the opportunity to really set the dialogue and drive the tone. And as Irela mentioned, the Chamber has been a leader in climate change and sea level rise for several years, and we hope to continue to have strong support to help make South Florida a global leader in resiliency. And I, too, am very excited to see so many people here today who want to dialogue on this topic. And so I will be very brief, and I'll just turn it right over now to Mr. Wayne Pathman, who's the chair-elect of the Miami Beach Chamber of Commerce. Wayne's been an active leader and communicator on this important issue, and he's also chair of the City of Miami's Sea Level Rise Committee. So, Wayne.
Thank you, Christine. I appreciate that. And I'd like to say, first of all, good morning to everybody. And secondly, it's great to see the two chambers coming together and working on this very important issue that affects our entire community. With that said, I'd like to say a little brief history of how I got involved and why it's so important for everybody really in our community to be involved in this issue. About 4.5 years ago, I was like many of you sitting here today. I knew very little or nothing at all about sea level rise. My first introduction to sea level rise was very similar to the setting here today when I was invited by former County Commissioner Katie Sorensen to a forum and learned about the issues facing our community. At that time, I met and became friends with Professor Harold Wanless, so you know that I got a real introduction about how bad things are going to be right away. Learning from him and others and becoming interested in how global problems could impact our community, it became of great concern and interest to me. I do not feel that it's doom and gloom. I believe, rather, that the opportunity to engage in dialogue with people like yourselves, people that are involved in community, people that are civic-minded as well as professionals, citizens in academia, scientists, government representatives at all levels, and other citizens to find solutions together. This is not a micro problem, it's a macro problem that affects our entire community. As I stand here today, I can say that the community has come a long way in trying to understand the issue of sea level rise and how it will affect our community now and in the future. But much still needs to be done. And what needs to be done, more importantly, is to involve the business community. As I look out in the audience today, I see a lot of people that I've seen at other events and industry but I don't see the stakeholders and business leaders of our community here today. And without them and without their being involved, it's going to be very difficult to push this issue forward. So the chambers have come together to try to work together to get the business community, because that's what we do as chamber chairman and chamber presidents. I hope that as a result of what you hear today and what we do as chambers together in the future, we'll bring those people to the table, which will help us actively get elected officials involved to start thinking differently about how we do things here in South Florida. I can tell you, as the chairman of the City of Miami Sea Level Rise Committee, and I have one of my members that's also on the committee, Jim Murley, we are really endeavoring to try to take this issue to a whole new level in the City of Miami, which is the largest city in Florida, and try to get them started on issues that will be resilient and sustainable for our future. Having been a panelist on many different occasions for many different organizations, or having even been involved in a field hearing study for Congress, it's very easy to kind of get lost in the weeds and not be able to see the real issues. But some of those issues that are most important are going to be issues like insurance, banking, and taxation. And all of us can have a role in trying to stop and help the issues related to how insurance is going to change and how banking is going to change in the near future. Today, you have a very learned panel. I hope that you listen to what they have to say, that their discussion should give you rise for concern, but also encourage you to be engaged and realize that there is opportunity to work together for the future. So with that, again, I'd like to say that it's a pleasure to be here, invited by the Greater Miami Chamber of Commerce, and that as the incoming chairman for the Miami Beach Chamber of Commerce, I look forward to working together to create a more resilient and sustainable future. Thank you.
Well, thank you both for such encouraging words, and an event like this would not be possible without the generous support of our sponsors. So we'll get right into those thank yous. I would particularly like to thank our presenting sponsor, Florida Power and Light, and ask Ms. Irene White, Senior Director for External Affairs, Miami-Dade, to come up and say a few words.
Well, everybody, good morning, and thanks so much for calling me Miss. I haven't been called Miss in a long time. It sure felt good. So we are very, very happy to be here as presenting sponsors. You know, I want to thank the chamber. Obviously, we got an incredible panel to have these discussions. But, you know, this is a situation where I think if we come together, we can figure out how to best find solutions so that we can move forward with what is probably the most beautiful and dynamic setting that we have to live in, as all living here in the beautiful south end of the state of Florida. I do want to say a little bit about Florida Power and Light while I'm here and I've been able to talk to you. You know, we're really happy to be recognized as one of the cleanest electric utilities in Florida, and we're amongst the cleanest in the nation. I think you'll be happy to know that there's some EPA standards that were set for the electric industry, and those are set for the year 2030. And here in our service territory, we have already met those standards. So standards that are for 2030, we've already met today. I hope that you're happy to hear that. You know, we were the first utility here in Florida to bring in a solar-powered plant. It was a hybrid plant in Martin. In fact, it was so interesting at the time that we even had the President of the United States come in for the inauguration of that plant because the technology was so advanced. Also, this year we're adding three new solar plants in the state of Florida. That's about 1 million solar panels. I don't know what it is if you line them up side by side by side, but it goes a very, very long way. And that's all going to contribute to reducing about 95 million tons of carbon emissions into the atmosphere. The last thing is that we have a ribbon cutting ceremony that's scheduled for the end of the month, and it's going to be at FIU. I see some FIU people here. And we're doing a very large project on research involving solar energy right there in the College of Engineering in the big parking lot. You will now see, as you drive on Flagler, you're going to see about 5,700 solar panels that have been installed. Not only will that generate another 1.6 megawatts of electricity from solar, but we have our young engineers who are going to be working with us, doing a whole heck of a lot of great research on solar energy. So I'm very excited for that. I'm very excited to be bringing in the youth and our future to be looking at solar energy and how to continue to work with it and make it to best to our ability. Now, a little bit about sea level rise and what we have been doing, just very briefly. One of the examples that we had was Sandy and the flooding that came in Sandy and what affected that, especially that area of Manhattan. We sent a lot of people not only to assist in restoration, but we also did a lot of study of what that meant to the electrical equipment. So after that, and after a lot of talks with Con Ed and whatnot about the learnings, so we have embarked and we have identified at substations. Substations for us are basically what transforms energy from high voltage to low voltage so that you can move them into our homes and businesses. What we're doing is we're putting real-time monitoring to be able to see how the water, if the water is advancing, what that looks like, so we can actually see it from control centers that we have. It's real-time data. We can then make some critical decisions on how to protect this very critical equipment that's foundational to movement of electricity throughout the grid. Also, we have been looking at how to make as waterproof as possible some of our facilities, and we're looking at, and we've added a lot of water intrusion protection and sump pumps to these critical facilities. So there's a lot that's happening. We're continuing to learn, and I'm going to turn it back to you, Idela. Thank you so much. I think we're going to have some great discussion and some great ideas how to move forward. Thanks very much. Happy to be here.
Thank you so much again to FPNL, our presenting sponsor. It's glad to hear that you're acting on climate, because that's what we're here to discuss today. We're also grateful to the following sponsors, our gold sponsors, 300 Engineering Group, Arcadis, FIU Sea Level Solution Center, Wade Trim, Nova Consulting, AECOM, Hazen and Sawyer, and our silver sponsors, Atkins, CH2M, Everglades Foundation, FR Aleman, Gresham Smith and Partners, HDR, WSI, Parsons, Brinkerhoff. The business community is here, and that's a testament to how important this issue is to our business community. Otherwise, I don't see how so many sponsors just came out of the woodwork. So that's very encouraging. When we started workshopping 4 years ago, I think there were a handful. So we've come a long way, and I'm really thrilled about that. I also want to thank the city of Coral Gables for providing their Coral Gables TV's crews who are videotaping today's conference. So we'll have a record of this so we can always go back and, learn and share this information with the rest of our community. Last but not least, I want to thank our amazing chamber staff, Danielle Borgi and Tania Valenzuela. You guys helped put this together, dealt with all the details. You make me look good, and I really thank you for that. So now we're going to get started. As many of you know, the issue of climate change and sea level rise at times has become a polarizing and political issue. However, we're very encouraged to see the recent creation of the Climate Change Caucus in Congress, headed by our very own Congressman Carlos Curbelo. And he is working proactively to engage his colleagues on the Hill in a dialogue to better educate and help us better prepare, the country better prepare, for resiliency and a sustainable future. And he was not able to be with us today, but he was doing his part promoting this event on the House floor, and we have a video that we'd like to share with all of you, because we're thrilled for the attention. extremely helpful to our community, specifically with the issues going on in the Florida Keys this session. And so, you know, we're so, so thrilled to have her fighting for us in Tallahassee every day. We also have the mayor of the Village of Pinecrest, the Honorable Cindy Lerner. We have Camilla Alvarez, Commission Aide to Miami-Dade County Commissioner Xavier Suarez. We have Commission Aide, I believe, Q Green from the office of Dade County Commissioner Juan Carlos Zapata. And I'm told that we'll have a, you know, walk-ins in and out, so as the day goes by, we'll hear from more. Ready? Not ready. Okay. It was working this morning. Obviously, things happen the way they're supposed to happen. Are we skipping it? We'll come back to it. All right. Well, 2 years ago, Miami-Dade County Sea Level Rise Task Force issued its final report, comprised of a series of recommendations to the mayor and the county commission to act upon. These recommendations became resolutions requiring Miami-Dade County to begin working on policies and projects intended to make our community resilient to storms and sea level rise. Since then, Miami-Dade has hired a chief resiliency officer, and I'm honored today to introduce Mr. Jim Murley as our opening speaker. Jim has an extensive background in planning, economic development, energy, emergency management, public policy, and all this in his lifetime. So, and he's still not done. He's got the biggest challenge ahead of him. So please join me in welcoming Jim, who will walk us through what Miami-Dade County's been doing lately.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you, Arella, for everything you've done in your slightly shorter career. Governing board member, Water Management District Chair, Miami River Commission, ever-present advocate of these issues. Yeah, but thank you. So the first person I met when I walked in off the elevator was the person who greeted us this morning, Barry Johnson. Barry Johnson has been doing work for this community for a decade, and I think you all know that recently he announced he was going to be not retiring, but being promoted to run of the foundation for the chamber. I'd like to recognize the work Barry Johnson has done for this community. He has been a great leader. Where are we going to get a voice like Barry's? We need to just tape it and, you know, play it. My goodness. Well, yesterday morning, woke and went on the computer, and there was the daily news on what the latest study on Antarctica, sea level rise, some pretty startling information. I want you to know that in the basement of the county building, we have a supercomputer, a special algorithm that we import the most recent news articles into in order to get the latest reading of what sea level rise might be. And I have, this morning I can announce what that's going to be. This is, we haven't had time to release this, but I want to let you know the sea level rise in the future will be huge. It'll be huge. And since this is a solutions conference, I want you to know that the Miami-Dade County Commission and the mayor are taking immediate action. They'll be adopting a resolution, otherwise known as a urging, commanding that the people of Antarctica pay for whatever damage happens to Miami. April Fools. Now, for the media and for whoever's filming this, and everything I just said is not attributed to Miami-Dade County government and should not be taken on the record as having anything serious to do with what I'm about to say. But there is an article every day, guys, and it is something that makes up the world that we live in this issue. And we want to talk about what Miami-Dade County is doing with a lot of partners, many who are in this room, and I'll try to acknowledge them as I make my remarks, but everyone out there knows that you're part of this overall effort in a state, in a country, in our county, our cities, in our neighborhoods. This needs to be a collective effort to deal with the short-term and long-term issues that confront us. I have a PowerPoint, and there's the gadget. Katie and Nicole, where are you? Nicole Hefty and Katie Hagerman, our staff that have helped me every day prepare for presentations like this. Please acknowledge the great work they do on behalf of the public. Okay, where do I point? Got it. So Miami-Dade County is a peninsula. We're part of a peninsula surrounded by water. That defines the very issue that we have to deal with as we think about climate change and sea level rise. Freshwater, the great freshwater wetland to the west, of which many people are here, Colonel Kelly and Colonel Kirk from the Corps Water Management District, many, many partners that are involved with Everglades restoration, which is a huge part of how we address the issues of climate change in our county. And of course, the Atlantic to the east, representing part of the global ocean system that is being impacted by the warming of the atmosphere and the expansion of the ocean. Really, a very small part of Dade County is where we are going to be have our habitat, or we're going to have our industries or our farming. Most of Dade County is already in public ownership. That's something we always should remember, because it's the management and restoration of stewardship of those green areas that in the long run are one of our best defenses to sea level rise and climate change. So we have an advantage in many ways as we move into this field. And we've got 34 cities that are very important. Mayor Lerner of Pinecrest is here, and all the other mayors in each in their own way are working collectively at the League of Cities, at state level, the national level, are partners in this process. Very touched. Okay, we have a history in Miami-Dade of working with this that goes back to 1990, where the county commission, under the leadership of Harvey Rubin, now clerk of the courts, started us on the road of addressing, reducing CO2 emissions in the county, setting aggressive goals as we move forward. And the county has pledged to various programs that have been set up nationally. We've set standards. We have an overall goal of an 80% reduction in our CO2 by 2050. From our starting year, which I think, Doug, might have been 1990. So that's an aggressive standard. We're making progress, but we're going to need a lot of help from a lot of people. Government alone cannot do or cannot make that goal of reducing CO2 without a lot of help. Great public servants have produced a sustainability plan, a green print plan, which is online and provides a overall sustainability approach for the county. And as Arella mentioned, we've had two citizen task forces, both chaired by now Clerk of the Courts Reuven, which have provided recommendations to the County Commission, which are folded up into the actions that the County Commission, by resolution, directs the administration. The latest of those are the Sea Level Rise Task Force recommendations, which County Commissioner Sosa, joined by Levine and Suarez, at least, were sponsors of asking the administration to provide some reports, which we'll talk about as we go through this, the PowerPoint. Hurricanes are part of the climate variability that we have to worry about, and we want to emphasize that all the time when we talk about the long-term issues of sea level rise. Sea level rise amplifies the tidal events and the storm events, and we have gone a long time without a hurricane, almost 12 years. NOAA will tell you that's about a 3% probability that we would go through a decade without a named storm hitting our area. So we're due, and we have a lot of people who have never experienced a storm, and that's a matter of education and outreach, and we have an excellent Office of Emergency Management in the county with partners in each one of the cities and private partners that work training in the absence of a storm all the time, but ready for when and if that event occurs. And of course, our primary sponsor, Florida Power & Light, does the same thing with their equipment and in preparation for an event we know is going to come sometime in our lifetimes. So I talked a little bit about mitigation and reduction of CO2. You know, but this blue print, I can almost hardly read it. Is that other mic going to be on if I go relative to the other end? Just start talking. Okay. We wanted to emphasize that the county already has a list of projects in our local mitigation strategy that help mitigate against storm events. And it's ironic that most of the funding to help you address these issues happens after the storm. When you read about what's happening in greater Atlantic area after Hurricane Sandy, there was a significant amount of money from the federal government that are helping a host of people recover. But that only came after they experienced the storm. What we need to do collectively, working with states and localities around on the coastal part of the United States, is somehow convince the Congress, and I think maybe even Colonel Kirk's going to talk about this a little bit, about helping us before the storm. That way we could really significantly reduce the damages that are going to occur to property and God forbid, lives in a major storm. So if you, in the business community, if you're interested in knowing the kinds of projects that are already designed and some that have been built and some that we would like to build if we had additional funds, you can get into the PowerPoint, the website of our Office of Emergency Management and see exactly what those projects are like. You can see some of the dollar figures. These are completed projects. This is the force pumping station, I think, at the Miami River, right at the control gate. This is a figure, ladies and gentlemen, that the Brookings Institute just issued. This is their estimate worldwide of the cost of the infrastructure that's going to be needed as we move forward to deal with these issues. Worldwide, this is a significant opportunity for public-private partnerships to deal with these issues. We didn't make up this number. The Brookings Institute made an analysis, and we thought it was important to put that frame on not only the opportunity, but the significance of the problem of thinking about the next generation of infrastructure that needs to be built, especially in our coastal communities. So we do wake up to these wonderful stories every morning that we call the doomsday press. But, you know, they're alerting the community. They're raising the issue. There's a lot of good information in these articles. There's a lot of good studies that are being done, a lot of forecast information. Sometimes it sends people off in the wrong direction, but, you know, overall, this is something, one, we can't control, and two, I think it helps elevate the world of the attention of everyone in the region, and that's really what we need at this point. The cycle of sea level rise, just in a short condensed diagram, really does happen from the sea emissions, effect it has in the atmosphere, the warming of the temperature of the atmosphere, the warming of the oceans, which is the thing we really are concerned about because that expands the water. And then there's that kind of major event that's hanging out there that you read a lot about, and that's the ice that's on the glaciers that are on land. It's not the ice on the that's floating in the water. If that melts, it's not a significant increase. But if those glaciers in Greenland or Antarctica start to accelerate in their breaking up or melting, that's when we're concerned about more accelerated rate of increases in sea level rise. So there are flooding issues that sea level rise amplifies. This is a picture of right in Miami Beach, I think. Betsy, right? Betsy's going to speak later, I think. And, you know, Miami Beach is being very proactive. The mayor and the city commission are moving to upgrade their pumping system, elevate some of their streets. They're partnering with the state and the county on other roads. And this kind of flooding can happen sometimes at the lunar high tides if, in fact, the circumstances are right and the drainage system is just not adequate to handle it. So that's why the city of Miami Beach, you'll see out there, out on the barrier island, is moving forward to take action on providing relief from this kind of nuisance flooding that can occur. Surge is the real danger that comes with a hurricane, also amplified by sea level rise. Hurricane Andrew was really a huge windstorm with a high level of surge, but it was dissipated both by the depth, how it came on shore in South Dade County. And if you think about it, the windstorm that we got from that happened during Andrew significantly changed the way we developed in the future. It significantly changed the Florida building code. That's probably going to happen to us also. We're going to have to make building code changes that reflect the kind of danger that would come from a large surge that is 25 miles north of South Dade. That would bring it ashore and its wide range in significant areas that have been developed. Our drainage system is really important in South Florida. It's one of the unique features about how we deal with the issue. The primary system, of course, is maintained by the South Florida Water Management District. Lee Hefty, who's the head of DERM, Division of Environmental Resource Management, and I visited with the new executive director yesterday in West Palm Beach at the Water Management District and emphasized with him the need for closer coordination between the county and the cities and everyone and the Water Management District as they maintain and improve their drainage system. And they're doing level of service studies, they call them, for flood protection and drainage for each of their basins. And they're really in-depth studies, and that's going to be very helpful to the local governments as we move forward. A little relief, you know, even a little sunny day flooding can provide some fun for somebody. But it also means salt water on the roads and damage to the underlying chassis of cars. And it really is something that our local governments have to deal with. They have to address this. Again, the pumping station in Miami, in the Miami River, sea level rise is going to have, obviously, effects on the on our coastal communities. This picture on the left is A1A in Fort Lauderdale as Sandy passed to the east at a high tide time, and there was significant undermining of the road and loss of the beach. But it was a good example of partnership by local governments working with the state and others to rebuild that critical link of road in a much more adaptation-friendly way, and to demonstrate how we can adapt to these kinds of events that are amplified by sea level rise. The same thing's happening to our natural systems. Our natural systems are being affected by encroaching salt water with the rising seas, so you're going to get a change in the nature of the vegetation. You're going to see saltwater tolerant vegetation moving inland. That's going to happen. That's not something we should necessarily worry about. It's a natural part of what we need to do. We do need to move water south. We need to get water into Everglades and Florida Bay, and so that'll have an effect on this erosion of the shoreline. But in most cases, nature is going to be our best protection in those situations. The underlying geology of our county, the limestone really is it's a sponge. It's great for the water business. It gives us a great aquifer, some of the best water in the world. But you know, it's not very it's pretty conducive to salt water also. So we have to work around that. That doesn't allow us to do certain things, at least right now, with the technology we know about, that might make sense in Holland and other, or Netherlands and other places. But it is it's the sponge we live on, and something that we have to be aware of as we move forward. So the regional compact was referred to. The four counties of Palm Beach, Broward, Miami-Dade, and Monroe, about 7 years ago, took it upon themselves to form a compact for the purposes of having a voice on policy issues in Tallahassee and Washington on issues dealing with climate change. And they have been able to do that. They've been very effective. They've also provided a peer-to-peer level of communication among county officials, county staff. We have a municipal outreach within the compact. We work with our universities who have excellent research going on at FIU at the Sea Level Rise Solution Center, and Dr. Troxler is going to talk about that. The compact is something that distinguishes Southeast Florida from the rest of the country, and we get a lot of people to come here to understand how we were able to pull this off, because frankly, one of the keys to this, it's very bipartisan. Regardless of party or other political things that might be occurring, the local elected officials in this region have found a way to get that toxic discussion, leave it somewhere else, and to have a type of discussion which allows the staff to do their work and for us to make progress as a region and communities. They also do a very important forecast for the region. It's the sea level rise forecast that has been done now for the second time. October 2015, we issued a second report was issued. There's a lot of information at the global and national level that forecasts sea level rise through scenarios over a number of years, but it's difficult to downcast that information to the region. And to do that, at least at this point, you really have to rely on the quality of the experts that we have in the region, the scientists that work at our universities, that work at our agencies, who can come together, review the available data, and make some assumptions about what makes sense for Southeast Florida. So this document is online. It's set to a 1992 baseline. It shows an historical trend that measures from the last 100 years, which was about a foot over the last 100 years of rise. But it also gives two mid-level and high-level projection and ranges based on various forecasts, which come from assumptions like what happens to the glaciers. So you can look at this, and it's important for the business community to think about it as, what are we, if you're designing a building or you're thinking about building something, what's the life of that facility? And then how do you use the projections to make a best estimate in terms of the risk that you want to take or the extra protection you want to build into the project? Lots of reports that we put out at the Compact. We have a design activity we do once a year called resilient redesign, showing possible ways that we might live in our county with significant sea level rise. And we have great partners, great collaboration. The task forces. Now I'm going to talk quickly here. Albrella, what are we doing? Probably need to pull bell. Okay. The task force reports have already modified our comprehensive development plan. We have amended the key sections of that, and that plan is very important in Miami-Dade County. We have various reports, which were the directives of the resolutions that I mentioned earlier. Those reports are in almost final form, so you'll see them coming out in April, and they'll look like this on their covers. They'll be online, and they'll be presented to the County Commission. They deal with insurance, flooding, use of adaptation action areas. Here's an example of some projected flooding, possible flooding in out years up in the Arch Creek drainage basin, given assumptions about how much water is already underground and what might happen in the future. I want to say, if you're from Miami-Dade County, you should be very proud of the work that is done by the county employees at the Water and Sewer Department and our drainage folks. They are excellent. Some of the folks are here. If we didn't have them, we would be in a lot worse shape in terms of addressing some of these issues, because we really get great quality work from those departments. We just recently had an announcement with the Nature Conservancy and CH2M to do two pilots on natural protection areas. One for the South Treatment Plant in South Dade, the possible use of intensifying a mangrove shoreline to protect the plant. Another is going to be up in the Wagner Creek area, if you know the medical district. Seabold Canal, Wagner Creek comes off the Miami River, and we're looking as that water body is upgraded and cleaned up, we'll do some activity along the banks, which will both allow for better protection during flooding and provide extra green space for the people who work in that area. More to the folks, to the credit of our Water and Sewer Department, they have been tasked by the County Commission to upgrade the entire system, and they literally will be spending billions of dollars of county funds. And they have used the best available information on sea level rise and storm surge in designing the upgrades to their facilities. Sorry about that. I missed one. Okay, great collaboration with the universities, municipal partners. Final slide. So this is a slide, actually not from Miami-Dade, but from Broward County. We've been learning to live with water in South Florida for a long time. This is Weston. The area to the far part of the slide is the Everglades. And the part that you see in the front part, where we've developed and dredged and created a community, used to look the same way. So now that area has drainage for the community. It has water bodies that are used recreationally and for drainage. That's been our history of living with water in South Florida. We won't be able to replicate this, probably couldn't replicate this under current permitting laws. But I think it reflects the kind of creativity and innovation that we're going to need to have as we move into the future. There are ways to live with water as it rises with sea level rise. There's ways to live with water as it becomes more intense during tidal events and during hurricanes. And I think given our past and the partnerships that exist today, I look forward in my position as Chief Resilience Officer to working with all of you in making those changes and learning to live with sea level rise. Thank you very much.
So Jim's going to join our panel discussion later, so we're not going to do Q&A right now. We're a little delayed, but we're going to go ahead and queue up. Are we ready, guys? Queue up the video? The congressman's video? In the meantime, I want to recognize some elected officials that have joined us. We have City of Miami Beach Commissioner John Aleman here with us this morning. And we also have Sean McCracken, an aide to Commissioner, County Commissioner Daniela Levin-Cava with us. And we're not gonna show the video. What we're going to do is we're going to take a break and assemble our panel. Take a 5-minute break, and we'll be right back. Or not. Yes, no? We'll keep trying. How's that? This is a bigger challenge than sea level rise, I think.
Will be held by the Greater Miami Chamber of Commerce this April. The conference brings together members from across Florida to have a constructive dialogue about ways to confront sea level rise in our communities. Attendees will also have the opportunity to be updated on the South Florida Regional Climate Compact and receive recommendations from Miami-Dade Sea Level Rise Task Force on the best ways to incorporate new methods to deal with climate change in our daily lives. The individuals who attend this conference have a passionate desire to keep our South Florida communities safe and viable for generations to come. Sea level rise is an important issue not only in South Florida, but a topic that's discussed in a bipartisan manner at the national level as well. I commend the attendees of the Sea Level Rise Solutions Conference for their leadership and for taking proactive steps to address rising sea levels. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield back.
Wasn't that great? Who says we don't have stakeholders at every level? So I want to just briefly thank Jim Murley for that very informative and concise presentation. Kind of sets the stage of where we are here in Miami-Dade County and the work that we still need to do. I am thrilled to have such a prestigious panel of experts from cross sections and cross sectors to discuss. This is going to be a solutions-oriented conversation. We're not gonna get into the science anymore. We're not gonna talk about the problem anymore. We're gonna talk about solutions. We're gonna learn what others have been doing around the country, and we're gonna talk about what we're doing here, even locally, to address some of these issues. With us today, we have Stephen F. Bourne, Project Director and R&D Chair, Atkins North America. You can just kind of wave. We have Quinn Eddins, Director of Research and Analysis for CBRE, the Florida Division. We're honored to have Colonel Jason Kelly, U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, District Commander for the Norfolk District. We have our very own Colonel Jason Kirk, U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, Commander and District Engineer, Jacksonville District. We have Dr. Tiffany Troxler, Director of the Sea Level Rise Solutions Center and Florida International University. We have Elizabeth Wheaton, Director of the Environmental and Sustainability Department of the City of Miami Beach. And in lieu of Stanley Young, who fell ill this morning, we have Albert Slapp, who worked collaboratively with Mr. Young on the designs of some of his residential properties. So he will be, he's a great substitute because they worked hand in hand on some of those projects. And Albert Slapp is the president of Coastal Risk Consulting, a brand new firm that had sea level rise not been an issue, they probably wouldn't exist today. So there you go. Sea level rise is good for business. So let's just, we're gonna go ahead and just get started with questions and have a back and forth conversation. I wanna start with Dr. Troxler from FIU and just briefly talk to us a little bit about some of the solutions FIU has begun to implement and why the Sea Level Solutions Center was created to begin with.
Hello. Can you guys hear me? Yes. Hi. It's a real pleasure to be here today. As Arella mentioned, I'm the director of the Sea Level Solutions Center. And FIU created this center in order to leverage the expertise of faculty across disciplines. So it gives us an opportunity to collaborate in an interdisciplinary way so that we can help to advance the understanding of sea level rise and help to inform decision making at all levels. So some of the work that FIU has been doing in trying to work toward solutions is in the context of science support. We have tremendous expertise in Everglades wetlands and trying to understand the how that natural resource that we all depend in terms of where we get our drinking water, where we are able to actually produces quite a bit of economic stimulus in terms of the tourist dollars that the Everglades provides. And also, as Jim mentioned a little bit, helps protect us from some of the risks associated with sea level rise and storm surge by, in part, attenuating some of that the storm surge that we would experience in our urban communities otherwise. So doing quite a bit of work in the Everglades research and helping to inform policy and management decisions to help understand how we can best utilize that resource to our collective advantage in terms of economic prosperity, environmental quality, among a few. We've also done a little bit of work in the context of our journalism school. So in terms of community engagement, that group in collaboration with other experts have put together informative documentaries that help the community to understand a little bit more about sea level rise in South Florida. And also have worked with our GIS center and some of our experts to try to develop sort of smartphone applications that just allow people to understand you know, where their communities might be in terms of elevation and how they might experience sea level in the future.
Tiffany, but knowing the audience we have here today, business owners, industry partners, et cetera, how can people work collaboratively with the center?
Yeah, thanks, Arella. Given the opportunities for collaboration and an interdisciplinary approach to the work that we take at FIU, they're great opportunities to inform and work with the business community on understanding some of the vulnerabilities, but also understanding how the business community can get ahead of what is projected for sea level rise to try to build that into their business plans, as well as try to develop new opportunities that can sustain economic productivity. Among those, trying to also get a general understanding of how our communities might be affected, but again, to try to understand how we can build that information into our business models and get a better handle on how we can incorporate that understanding to to help support our business productivity. So the what we can offer at FIU is you know just a source of information, a collaborative space that businesses can get involved in, and we want this to be a dynamic conversation because you know we do have a good understanding of how we can create new business opportunities, but in getting a better understanding of what your direct and immediate needs are, we can work collaboratively on the best solutions for this stakeholder group.
Great, thanks. I have a burning question for Jim Murley that a lot of folks here in this audience wanna know. Do you anticipate future business opportunities from Miami-Dade County for the contracting and engineering industry for resiliency and storm readiness projects similar to what we have with the Miami-Dade Water and Sewer Capital Improvements Program?
Well, yes, we do. It's a good analogy, I think, Arella, because of the magnitude and size and timing of the upgrade of the water and sewer system is in the billions of dollars. And of course, the county has a regular 5-year capital improvements plan that every agency on a regular basis looks at what they have and what they may need. And we're asking them to do it in the short term to see what upgrades are needed from the standpoint of resilience. But one of our tasks and one of the reports that'll be available this month is for an enhanced capital improvements plan. And that's our best judgment at this point, based on studying what was designed after Sandy, New York, after Katrina in New Orleans, and other places around the world, of what might be a larger scale infrastructure, both green infrastructure and built infrastructure, that could be used to provide a more enhanced level of resilience for the community. We don't have detailed specs. We have recommendations on how we go forward in that process, but it will be an option for the County Commission to consider.
Well, that's good news, right, engineering folks? That's what we like to hear. There will be business opportunities as a result of resiliency building. So next up, we have Mr. Boren from Atkins North America, and you've been very involved in resilient city planning, and what are the key factors that cities should keep in mind when trying to build in resiliency and adaptation into their projects?
Okay, thank you. Good question.
Thank you.
It's almost though I wrote it myself. I'm actually putting out a paper that should be out next week about this. We have at Atkins a program called Future Proofing Cities. It was the brainchild of our global CEO in 2012, and it sort of has been spread around the world. We have done projects in Asia Pacific, in the Middle East, in North America. I'm actually the lead for the North American push for future proofing cities. My background is actually in decision support system building, and you know, a lot of what we find resilient cities need to do comes from the same concepts of decision theory that decision support systems are made of. Probably the key one is ownership. You know, a scientist isn't going to change a city. A scientist might provide information about the city, about what will happen. The federal government isn't going to change the city. The state government isn't going to change the city. The city has to change the city. That's probably the number one. You know, there's an ownership related to the process. There's an ownership related to the tools that are used to understand what information is derived and what decisions that information is based on. And so, you know, the ownership aspects of the whole process of resiliency building, the inclusion of everyone in the community, it builds relevance for the plans that you make. It builds vigilance in actually trying to execute the plans. And so that's probably the most important factor, I think.
Excellent. I believe you have a slide. You brought a slide or two?
I do. Can I?
Yep, go for it. There it is. Future-proofing cities.
Okay, so this is just a diagram of the essential process that we go through with future-proofing cities. It revolves around smart planning makes smart cities. So future-proofing cities here is a master planning process. At the beginning of it is a report card or a vulnerability report. We call it a vulnerability report, but it's actually a comprehensive study of the city. If you looked at Miami Beach, for instance, in 2011, you know, if you trained a camera on the sea level, you'd see it was rising if you left it there for years and years. But if you moved your camera over slightly, you'd notice that there are, I think, 40% more visitors in the city of Miami Beach than there were in 2011 right now. That speaks opportunity to us. What that means is there is a strong and bold economy in this place that's threatened by sea level rise. And so we need to understand, what are the strengths of the community? What does it have sort of, you know, in its magazine to attack a problem like sea level rise? So we do this report card to kind of identify those strengths and weaknesses. And then after that, we go into a process, a stakeholder workshop process, where we build a model of the city. It's called an agent-based model. If anyone's familiar with transportation planning, an agent-based model should sound familiar. It is essentially a model of each individual in the city, their job, their salary, their education level. That model is run forward 40 years into the future, and we model the growth of the city, the economic growth, all factors, social growth, social problems. And within each year, we also model disasters hitting the city, disasters that are informed by UN IPCC forecasts. So we actually get within this stress testing process a picture of exactly what will happen to the city in terms of its economics, in terms of its ability to rebound from disasters, in terms of, you know, we're directly measuring the resilience of the city.
Interesting. You call that stress testing.
Right. It came from, the 2008 financial crash. The decision by banks and governments around the world after that was to stress test the economic system. And so they would actually run the conditions, the housing bubble, in these models using the simulators of the economic system and see what actually happens if they adopt different measures. We thought, well, this is kind of the same situation. You're not really going to get an answer about it unless you model everything that's going to occur, including urbanization and including sea level rise and including climate change. So let's just go ahead and make that the core of our process, the stress testing.
So I want to point out, this is an example of solution-oriented planning for sea level rise. And it's a great segue to my next presenter, Ms. Wheaton from the City of Miami Beach. They're on the front lines. They've been dealing with this. They had no choice. So it's obviously very exciting. You're implementing pumps, you're raising roads, and you're just dealing it with it head on, and your community is behind you. They're actually paying for a lot of this. Can you give us kind of like a brief overview of where you are right now and some of the examples of some of the solutions you've seen and how they've worked?
Sure. Thank you. I'm very pleased to be here today speaking to this group. I want to say that it all started when our mayor was elected into office a few years back, and it's started with the leadership. It really took the mayor, the city commission, and our city manager to make this a priority. And that has allowed staff now to move forward with implementing the adaptation strategies. The first step for us was to look at our stormwater management and how we're dealing with stormwater in the city. And it was clear that we needed to develop a plan that incorporated sea level rise into the models. So we began that process. We developed a $400 million program in order to do our infrastructure upgrades, which include installation of pump stations, installation of backflow preventers to prevent the tides from coming back up through the outfalls, and the raising of roads. We've begun that work in the lowest lying neighborhood, which is Sunset Harbor. Any of you that are familiar with Sunset Harbor, it's a very popular neighborhood now, consisting of condos as well as businesses, restaurants, and there, right now we've already begun to install those pumps, raise the road. We've raised the roads in some areas 2.5 feet. And now we're beginning to look at how that interfaces with the existing built environment. And these are, it's a learning process. So as we move forward with the projects, we're also seeing how that works with the urban design. And now we're beginning to look at the longer range plans. So looking at our city codes to see how we need to update those in order to accommodate for the public infrastructure upgrades. So yeah, thank you.
And how are you working with the natural system in implementing some adaptations? I know you have a dune program that you're working on, and that sounds incredibly interesting because, you know, in South Florida, the environment is the economy. So whenever we can use the environment to protect ourselves, we can and we should.
Yes, why people come to Miami? It's because of our natural resources. It's the fact that we have a very healthy bay, we have beautiful beaches, and our first line of defense is the coral reefs, then the beach, and then the dune system. So when the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers came in and did the large beach renourishment project back in the 70s, they also built in a dune system. And that dune was originally just a berm. Then they came back in and vegetated it, and now we're seeing that is continuing to not only provide storm surge protection, but natural habitat. We have migratory birds that use that for feeding. In some areas, the dune has risen, has actually grown, so naturally been able to accumulate sand upwards of 10 and 12 feet. So we've now gained that additional level of protection along our eastern seaboard. So we want to look for opportunities like this where natural infrastructure can provide that natural protection. So on the western side of the island, we're looking at how we can better incorporate mangroves into our design. So looking at hybrid seawall approaches. It's a challenge that we have 63 miles of shoreline along the western coast. And if we just use the sheet pile, we're not putting in that buffer that can further attenuate that wave energy. So now as we move forward with projects, we're looking to see how we can incorporate natural shorelines and hybrid approaches. So kind of trying to find that balance between green and gray. And that's, where we want to challenge the design community, the engineers, as well as the environmental community and the regulatory agencies, is how can we begin to look at these projects as being more than just that standard gray approach. And we really are gonna have to think outside of the box, but as we're gonna change and become a more resilient city, we need to be looking at how natural systems can be a part of that.
Wonderful. More solutions, I love it. That's another great segue to our next presenter, Albert Slapp, who is going to speak to us about his company's collaboration with Great Door Luxury Homes, who's a builder who's incorporating resilient design into multi-million dollar homes on Las Olas. And I found that incredibly interesting and encouraging. And that's not interesting and encouraging. What is that? Is that AV or is he an alarm? Fun technical difficulties today, all day long. Sorry about that, you guys. Well, now we know the emergency management alarm works. Now, works too well. Okay, hopefully we're good. So back to Albert. can you talk to us about how you collaborated with Stanley and his projects and the new technologies that you guys worked on together to plan this project? I think we have a slide, so okay. We can go ahead and show some photos.
Okay. So
of the project.
I guess I'm coming at this from a little bit of a different direction. We like to talk about, when we talk about climate adaptation success, that's what we're all here about, climate adaptation success, not retreat, not doom and gloom, but how are we going to adapt to the climate change that we know is happening, and we can actually see it, especially in the king tide periods. So most of the folks here on the panel, and many of you in the audience, are dealing with this, what we call top-down, in the sense of you work for government or large industry, and you're dealing with this in a top-down approach with large infrastructure projects. But our position with this new technology company that we started in Plantation is that if the individual citizens, small businesses, sit back in a relaxed state and say, government is going to save us. We just have to wait, and all these projects will save us. This is not going to achieve climate adaptation success. So the bottom up needs to do its share. Well, what is its share, and how do they know, and how can they get the information that they need to take adaptation steps? So we call it actionable data and analysis. So that's why Coastal Risk Consulting was formed. And I like to say that we have three fathers, one of which was, who recently passed away, very sad, Pete Harlem from FIU, who helped with some of the initial maps of sea level rise for this area. And from FAU, my co-founder, Dr. Leonard Berry, and then from University of Miami, Dr. Brian Soden, from the Rosenstiel School. So those are three of the academic and scientific fathers of Coastal Risk Consulting. But how we got involved with Stanley Young, and he couldn't be here because he wasn't feeling well, but boy, I wish I was I was in his shape, because he's still running triathlons, he's doing triathlons and marathons. Maybe he just got worn down from his training schedule, I don't know. You know, he's an amazing person, and I wish that really he was here today. But he had reached out because of a project that he had in Las Olas Isles on Mola Avenue to Coastal Risk. And he just had a local architect and engineer. He had bought the property in Las Olas that was owned by the billionaire Wayne Huizenga. And they basically knew that the property was very floody. They knew they probably got a good deal on it. I can't tell you what sort of a discount he got on buying the property, but everybody knew that it floods all the time. Now, not in some dystopic future 10, 15, 20 years from now, but it's flooding now all the time. So he asked us the question, can you tell me how high I need to raise this property and how long that's going to last me? And of course, I feel very comfortable sitting here with Army Corps of Engineers folks, because embedded in our technology is the Army Corps of Engineers model. And customers can choose low, medium, and high curves. They can choose a NOAA curve. If they wanted Jim Hansen's curve, we could toggle Jim Hansen's. It doesn't matter. It's up to the customer. But we downscaled both this tidal sea level rise flooding and storm surge using the NOAA SLOSH model. And we do this on the Amazon cloud, and we provided for him almost instantaneously the answer to his question. So his property was around 2.7 feet. I don't know if there's any other pictures to show, but it was at about 2.7 feet. And then our scientists, some of them who are sitting over there, Dr. Karen Bolter, Sarah Danka, who will be getting her PhD at FAU coming up. Congratulations to Sarah. They told him he had to raise his property to 5 feet, and then he put his foundation, if you put your foundation on top of that, which will have the base floor elevation at 6 feet, using the Army Corps of Engineers model, you will go from a red score to a green score. And he said, you know what? I'm building multi-million, I mean, when we talk about bottom up, I mean, this isn't exactly grassroots. He's building multi-million dollar spec homes, but it's more grassroots and more bottom up than a multi-billion dollar water treatment plant or something like that. But in any event, he said, you know, I'm going to show the prospective buyers the before and after. I'm going to show them that it was red and now it's green. And what I'm, I guess, here to say in working with Stanley and providing this information and analytics is that we need bottom-up and top-down working together or we're not going to achieve climate adaptation success.
Thank you so much, Albert. And, you know, again, another example, small scale, but another example of a solution and someone who took initiative, a builder who just thought, you know what, my product could probably be much more competitive than any other products out there. And so it's a conversation we need to continue to have as a community. So we saw some residential examples, and now we're going to jump into the commercial real estate industry. And we have, fortunately, we have Quinn Eddins, Director of Research and Analysis for CBRE, the Florida Division of Commercial Real Estate. And, you know, how seriously, really, is the commercial real estate industry taking sea level rise and, you know, some of this storm threats? And and what challenges does the industry, you know, face right now?
Is this thing on? All right. Well, first I'd like to say thank you to Irella and to the Chamber for inviting me to participate here today. I'm excited and happy to create a connection and build the connection from the commercial real estate community here in South Florida with the larger business community and with the public sector to address this issue. But so to answer the question, yes, the commercial real estate industry is starting to take the issue of climate change seriously, and increasingly so. I've seen a marked increase over the last few years. Over the last year, I've spoken to a number of national and even global real estate investors, commercial real estate investors and developers who have said Miami, South Florida has a lot of the characteristics that we look for in a market where we want to invest and build, but we have concerns about resiliency. And I've been asking what is the local community doing, the business and government community doing to address the issue. And I have to say that I think this is represents a great opportunity for the commercial real estate industry in South Florida because we're in a competition for investment with other major real estate markets across the country, New York, Boston, Norfolk, Philadelphia, on the West Coast, Los Angeles and San Francisco that are also have very large exposures to future losses due to climate change and coastal flooding. And here in South Florida, we're really ahead of the curve with everything we've done already, with the Sea Level Rise Task Force, with creating the Office of the Chief Resilience Officer, the investments in water and sewer, a number which we've all discussed today. These are steps that many other markets aren't taking. And I think it's an opportunity for the commercial real estate industry down here in South Florida to use that to sell the dream of South Florida to potential investors and say, listen, if you come here due to these steps, an investor who invests in South Florida commercial real estate will in the end, if we continue to lead, pay lower insurance premium, get beneficial terms and financing as a result, and have reduced exposure in the long run to flooding. And I think that's all a feather in our cap, and we need to be leveraging it more to attract that investment.
I hope the media is quoting you. But really, you know, when you market South Florida and you start, and I think Jim mentioned it, and I mentioned the media because, you know, we keep seeing these articles, ground zero, ground zero, ground zero. Do you think that has affected our brand or not? And if not yet, what should we be doing, what should we be saying to counter that? Well, maybe the media needs to be quoting better people, like people on this panel.
Well look, I think your real estate investors are folks who, they read the papers, and that's kind of driving these questions that I've been getting.
Right.
I have to tell you, 2 years ago, the preferred response when asked about sea level rise was to change the subject. And now you're getting folks, and it's still early days, but you're getting serious people asking serious questions. I think what the South Florida, the real estate community, and the larger business community needs to work on, or our primary challenge, I think, is one of incentives. When I look at from the perspective of the commercial real estate community, one of the primary challenges is, I guess, a problem of externalities, which we all collectively, it's in our best interest to invest in the short run to mitigate huge potential losses in the long run. The problem is, individually, developers, investors, don't have the incentive to act unilaterally. For instance, if I'm a real estate investor looking to purchase a property in a competitive market, and the South Florida commercial real estate market is a very competitive market for investment. If I internalize, if I take into account in my underwriting those potential future costs and the costs of insurance, and my competitors don't, I'm not going to bid as high as they do for a property, and I'm not going to be able to place much capital. And as a real estate investor, there's nothing worse than not investing in real estate. I mean, you don't make your fees by keeping your investors' money in CDs, and they expect you to put it into the real estate. Likewise, if I'm a developer and I build a property, I build an apartment building, and I put it on a 10-foot podium at considerable cost, and an investor's not willing to pay up for that resiliency feature, then I'm going to lose money. I'm not going to be profitable. So it's kind of the key challenge that I see it from the real estate perspective we all need to align our incentives for it to act collectively. So we can basically all jump at once. And then once we've done that, we can, there will be the incentives to take action and build resiliency into the built environment.
Yeah, and leveraging all these solutions that are already being implemented in those communications, I think, is key. Well, thank you. And we're so lucky we have two colonels, not one, but two. With us, we have Colonel Jason Kirk from the Jacksonville District. And Colonel, my question is, what authorities does the Corps have to support our local and state entities and agencies in their efforts to increase resiliency on our coast, specifically on our coastal and built infrastructures?
Excellent. Arella, great question. my colleague down, I might have seen that question once before. But I appreciate the invite and the chance to be here. Elected officials, great that several of you are here. Betsy, one of our customers and partners on the Miami Beach Coastal Storm Risk Management Project. I want to start off by telling you, as your Jacksonville District Commander, so I am the local guy representing 780 teammates that work across Florida and down to Puerto Rico to serve the nation in doing three big things. And we're wearing the dress-up uniform up here, but here's the fatigues that you're all used to. to remind me and remind us all that the Army Corps supports national security, number one, works to energize our economy, number two, and works to increase resilience, number three. And those are the three big elements of our mission. And we do that collaboratively, which is part of why we're here. And, you know, we talk about serious people talking about serious things. You know, the reason you have two Army colonels here is the President's executive order, is the Secretary of Defense's guidance, is our Lieutenant General, Chief of Engineers, Lieutenant General Bostic's guidance that has told us to work both in the mitigation realm, which gets at the emissions and other potential causative factors, so the mitigation realm, and then the adaptation realm. And so the adaptation is mostly what we're talking about today. So the question, the authorities that the Corps has, we have several and have had several through the years. So I just quickly want to talk about kind of from small to large. So using, and some of you, we have a mayor here, ma'am, may be familiar with the Continuing Authorities Program. And there are several different authorities that Congress put into play years back. And so an example of a CAP project is the Mount Sinai project, just up the road, trying to look at the stream bank. It's a stream bank and shoreline protection authority, but taken, again, a small Mount Sinai, an important regional hospital that is at risk and identified point of risk. And so local leaders have said, hey, Corps of Engineers, use your existing authority, come in and help us develop solutions. And that feasibility report we think will be done in February of 17. And we've got about $5 million that we've been able to compete for to put on Mount Sinai. So that's a very small example through continuing authorities. Then you window out to coastal storm risk management, where we don't just look at Betsy's Beach, but we look at, and that project is actually the Dade County beach erosion. It's called control project, because that was the old word, but just a term of art here that I want you to be clear on, is we now call that portfolio coastal storm risk management. And there's a reason for that, and Albert kind of referred to it, is there's a range of risk, and is engineers who are maybe more humble than our forebears, you know, Lewis and Clark that we chart in our history, we're humble, and so we're careful about saying we're going to protect or we're going to control Mother Nature. So it's titled Coastal Storm Risk Management, but that Dade County project runs from Government Cut up to Sunny Isles. And then some of you in the room are familiar with the limited reevaluation restudy, the sand study we just did, and we looked regionally at the sediment resource. And so when we do the next phase of Miami-Dade's project, we'll actually use or look to use some sand from up off of St. Lucie in government waters and federal waters. That's one of the important pieces that I've got to point out, because there's been some confusion as to, you know, that sand source. It's in federal waters, more than 2.5 miles off the shore. And so that is the most economically feasible bulk sand source. And then we're also going to be doing some upland trucking, some truck-in sand. So coastal storm risk management, another part of our portfolio. Then I cannot sit here as your Jacksonville commander and not mention the Everglades. I just spent the last 2 days running around the Everglades, seeing some of our done and almost done projects up at Kissimmee and down at Picayune Strand. So the Biscayne Bay Coastal Wetlands Project, that's near and dear to folks sitting right here. It's part of SERP, it's part of SERP Generation 2, it's part of our partnership with South Florida Water Management District, who's already done a good bit of work there. You've seen notes about, you know, cost share balance, and what's going on there is some of the work that the state has already done is not yet part of the partnership, because we haven't signed the project partnership agreement for Biscayne Bay Coastal Wetlands, so all of that effort is still on the state side of the ledger because it hasn't become part of the agreed upon. But we see being able to do that in the next year or two. Some of you know where the L31 East Flowway is, and that's the next planning effort for the federal government, and then the state intends to get working on Cutler Wetlands in 2020. So Biscayne Bay Coastal Wetlands is part of the broader Everglades, certainly a resiliency measure worth mentioning. Some of you are familiar with the interagency flood risk management study that we did with Miami-Dade County, South Florida. Again, the Nature Conservancy was a part of that, and then we leveraged Department of the Interior and USGS. And so that's helped develop a risk reduction decision support system that I think Jim Murley is now using and will continue to modify. So kind of windowing out through that interagency effort across Miami-Dade County. And then finally, what I want to mention, and my colleague Jason Engel will talk more on it in his keynote wrap-up, is the South Atlantic Regional Systems Management Strategy. So what is this you're talking about, Colonel? Well, here's the big picture. As I'm sitting next to my brother, Colonel Kelly from Norfolk District, who is part of, and he'll talk about, Norfolk's efforts post-Superstorm Sandy and what they're doing both locally and regionally. And we all know about the efforts post-Katrina. So what General Turner, our boss at South Atlantic Division in Atlanta, has charged us with is to do so Jason's part of the North Atlantic Comprehensive Coastal Study that was post-Sandy. We're trying to work a South Atlantic Comprehensive Risk Assessment that is pre the next event. So you'll hear more about that. Miami-Dade, there are other partners that we're going to work with to bring that together. So that's a wrap-up of key authorities of why your Corps of Engineers is in this business here in Florida and South Florida.
That's excellent, Colonel Kirk. Thank you so much, and we really appreciate the support that the Corps gives us pre and post. thank you for mentioning Biscayne Bay Coastal Wetlands Project. I think of all the Everglades projects that have, you know, that are part of the system, because Biscayne Bay is so important to our drinking water supply, expediting that project in particular will help us battle the saltwater intrusion issues. So whatever we can do, and I'm speaking out to the community as a whole, we need to advocate for that to move forward as soon as possible. But thank you so much again for being here and sharing all the projects. There were some that I don't think we even knew about. So thank you so much. And now moving over to hearing some of the post-storm stories and lessons learned and projects that you're implementing to make those areas more resilient in the Northeast. In particular, maybe you can talk to us, Colonel Kelly, about the Norfolk Flood Risk Study and also the Comprehensive Coastal Study that we might just be engaged in shortly.
Well, thank you, Rilla. First, I'd like to certainly recognize the elected officials, civic leaders, fellow servants of our great country, the state of Florida, and perhaps most relevant on this occasion, those from the city of Miami. Rare is the occasion that I'm afforded the opportunity to speak outside of the Commonwealth and not be on stage with the usual suspects of the Commonwealth of Virginia. So I am grateful for this opportunity, and I'd like to thank Mr. Steve Williamson for my presence today as a result of a conversation over breakfast, sharing with a friend some of the things that are going on in the city of Norfolk. And so I am certainly honored to be here, and I'm especially excited about the title of this particular conference, because for me, my assumption is that those in the room are done admiring the problem. And that in and of itself, as we move beyond the conversation of what's going on, is very helpful. So the Norfolk Flood Risk Management Study, several months ago, we signed a cost share agreement to embark on a study with the city of Norfolk that is really an extension, an expansion, the result of the North Atlantic Cole's comprehensive study. We're actually taking advantage of the inertia, the momentum of post-Sandy. And I think it's insightful and wise to think about something similar for the region here. And I applaud General Turner for what he's doing at the division level, and certainly for Jason, what he's doing. Admittedly, we've had a number of challenges advancing new projects. And so I think the best way to think about what we've been able to do with the NACs, as it's commonly referred to, and why I'm an advocate for what Jason just mentioned in terms of the studies prior to the next storm, is this hurdle that we have nationally in terms of new starts. The new start decision is made at the agency level, and that's to initiate a feasibility study or construction. And in order to get started, each project needs an affirmative new start decision. Nationally, we're afforded 10 new starts for feasibility studies and 6 for construction. The value of a study like the North Atlantic Coast Comprehensive Study, or even as we embark here in this region on something for the South Atlantic Division, is it will permit the harnessing of the inertia. It will bring to the forefront. And it is the road to the federal dollars. It is the interest. It's this competition that's taking place for these new studies. So what has resulted is extreme competition for our priority mission areas. I think it is incredible, Jason. When we talked about this idea over the phone several months ago, I was really excited because what's happening in Norfolk is the result of work done during Sandy. It's taken almost 4 years to get to that federal cost share agreement that I talked about. And we're now completing a study that won't be done until 2019. So, as Mr. Eddins mentioned, the fact that Miami's taking this on, the fact that this region understands the need to get started, is exactly the sort of assurance that I think the business community, and Jason spoke to our economic interests and the role we play for the nation as federal engineers, is the right way to go. In the city of Norfolk, I recently attended a workshop that was conducted by the Rockefeller Foundation. And in it, we were in the room. Rockefeller was facilitating the conference. We had the Navy, for Norfolk is a huge Navy town, large Navy presence. And they have what's called a joint land use study. And they're starting to think differently about the interaction of the community and the base. They're starting to think differently about the impacts of what we are observing and what adaptation is necessary. The reason why I mention it is because it's all another opportunity to advance. We're bringing folks into the room and we're collaborating, but we're taking action. And that's the thing that I think I'm most excited about. And every time I get a chance, I speak to what we're doing in the Hampton Roads area. And one other thing that has been mentioned today that I'd like to just sort of highlight is that the collaborative requisite, the collaborative necessity of an endeavor such as this. We're doing a study, and it's titled aptly, and it is indeed the Norfolk Flood Risk Management Study. But the truth of the matter is water has no boundaries. So if you study what's happening in Norfolk, it's insufficient. Though we will complete our study and we will take into account those things that are happening as a result of recommendations we make to the surrounding community. But I spoke last week at a regional session for Hampton Roads. And the thing that I tried to impress upon those is it will not be enough for us to offer solutions to Norfolk only. We're now seeking additional study authority, and we have
talked to the Virginia delegation. It's been harnessed, and I think we are soon going to receive study authority that's going to allow us to look at the community, Commonwealth of Virginia writ large, and take into account the peninsula, the northern neck, the eastern shore, and other aspects of the region, and realize that this is a system and that we have to have a system approach, and it is not dependent on the political boundaries. And so that's another hurdle that we're working through right now. But I started my comments speaking to how we've harnessed what was done post-Sandy, and it has been the impetus, the manner in which we achieved funds to what I think is just the beginning. And the Norfolk Flood Risk Management Study, I believe, will be foundational to the manner in which the Commonwealth of Virginia responds to rising seas and climate change.
Thank you very much. You have your hands full.
that we do.
I have one question. When obviously it's post-Sandy, when you've implemented some of these solutions and obviously infrastructure improvements, how has that affected the local economy with regards to jobs and contracting opportunities? I know that's something that our audience is very interested in hearing. And so, because as we move forward in our own study eventually, you know, we're going to start obviously benefiting from that as well.
A great deal. And the first thing I say to that is the city of Norfolk, and I'll use Norfolk because that's who we have the city, has been a great non-federal sponsor. I think that if you look, and Jim, what we were talking earlier, Norfolk is one of the 100 resilient cities. They're doing work with Rockefeller. I think that, and this is also in the vein of Mr. Adams, Norfolk is demonstrating its response to the realities of the region. So Norfolk is not only threatened by rising seas, but subsidence is also a challenge that the city faces. So it is not okay for Norfolk to talk about what some in academe are speaking to in terms of this 30 to 50 year horizon. Norfolk is wrestling with recurrent flooding today. As a result, in order to attract businesses, in order to encourage real estate investment, it's imperative that they demonstrate their willingness, their taking action, and learning to live with water. We used that term earlier, Jim. That is used often in the city of Norfolk, and much of what they're trying to do is just that, learn to live with water. So in terms of industry, in terms of engineers, in terms of opportunities, in terms of real estate development, it's booming.
Great.
And it's as a result of the commitment that the city has made. I will tell you that there are many that are concerned because Norfolk has a city manager form. The power seat is a city manager, but they have had a mayor. Mayor Frame has been in for 20 years. He's retiring this year. So he's been able to do some things as a result of longevity, tenure, the vision. So now they've got to figure out. So there will be some transition in Norfolk, but I think that the flood risk management study, we have some other things that we're doing with the port in terms of deepening that irreversible momentum has been, I think, attained and acquired. And so I think for the foreseeable future, we'll continue to see investment, we'll continue to see opportunity in that region as a result.
Great, and that's learning from other areas and examples of other what other cities are doing is great. I'm going to turn it over to Jim Murley because he has some exciting news about Rockefeller.
Thank you, Arella, and to both colonels, thank you so much for being with us today. Ladies and gentlemen, I think that what they described to us, the opportunity to put in place before the storm, some of the actions, the positive things that we've seen post-Sandy, is really something we should rally behind and get our congressional delegation and our leaders, public and private, to do. I think that would be unmeasurable support to everything we're trying to do to have that as a backdrop. Secondly, Colonel mentioned the Rockefeller Foundation and the Resilient 100 Cities program. Our county commission, welcome Commissioner Levine Cava, had directed the administration to apply, and we had the assistance and ongoing assistance, the Miami Foundation. I think Jane is here, Jane Albert, right? And they accomplished a rare feat of getting the county and two cities to sign a joint application together, Miami and Miami Beach. We have applied. We should hear this month. We're hopeful. I wish I could say we had it, but it will be an important step in the evolution of the Miami-Dade County working with our cities. Strong part of our application is the compact, the regional compact. That strengthens every time a single application goes forward, the compact strengthens that. So I did want to acknowledge the recommendations that the two colonels gave to us and the importance the Rockefeller Foundation designation will have. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Jim. And now, Q&A. So if you have any burning questions for any of our panelists, I think we have a mic somewhere over there.
I don't know if anybody has looked at this issue, but we see the maps, we watch the models, and we see our house is at 8 feet, so we're good. We don't have to worry. And I'm wondering if anybody has connect the dots for people with that attitude, that if their whole community is being, or parts of their community are being impacted, that their value, the value of their home, their asset, is going to be negatively affected too, so they're not okay. You know, looking at the maps, we might feel comfortable, and we might think, okay, you know, we joke, we're going to have waterfront property. But if Miami Beach is compromised, the effect on the economy of this community, if Biscayne Bay continues to decline and the fisheries resource is not supported, then that affects all of us. And I think maybe if that information is attended to, and the media understands that the people who are sitting in the armchair thinking I'm good, they're not.
Is it more of a statement, Sam, or a question?
Is anybody putting that together for
Albert.
Us?
Albert.
Well, let me go back to Stanley's situation. So in this peninsula and this area of Las Olas Isles, which are very low, he wasn't the only one with flooding. And even though he could afford to spend $1 million to go from 2.7 feet up to 6 feet and build up the seawall and the bulkhead, the road is still very floody. So he's now getting together with his neighbors to go back to the city of Fort Lauderdale and begin to talk to them about raising the road and taking other steps like the backflow preventers and things like that. So again, I get back to my point of bottom up and top down working together. So you're gonna have the large plans, you're gonna have the big projects led by the Army Corps and others. But and I wanted to actually kind of put something out to Colonel Kelly, which really I think is very relevant to the chamber on the small business side. I believe this is a true statement that in Hampton Roads and in Annapolis area, you have more a business of raising homes and putting the flood vents in and flood products than probably any place in America. Okay, so that I think that's true. And if that's true, what does it tell us about those businesses and the growth of raising homes, flood vents, and flood products, removable floodgates, et cetera? You see them on the internet. They're beginning, they're very, I think, much bigger in the UK than they are here. But could you tell us, just from your view, again, as a resident of that area, what you are seeing and how that relates to the growth of small businesses that are going to help the bottom up do their share?
Okay, if I could, I'd like to also address what you offered. I sat, it's probably 6 months ago, I attended a session with superintendents, school superintendents in the region. And where that conversation went was not so much about schools that were being flooded or that were in danger as a result of some of the recurrent flooding. They were looking at the economics of busing, the economics of when they close roads and schools as a result. So it's a sort of spinoff of what you talked about
the acknowledgement that the particular location may be okay, but there's a cost associated with making that particular location or allowing it to serve its purpose with the reality of what's happening around it. And there are dollars associated with decisions made as a result. So there are folks thinking about the impacts, thinking about even if you say I'm okay, that may or may not be true writ large or with a, you know, beyond the boundaries of your particular property. And Albert, I agree that we are seeing a lot of, and I'll refer to as non-structural solutions, you know, from the raising and doing, there's some of that going on, but I would tell you that in addition to the opportunities afforded those that are in that business, particularly small business, I would agree. We, within the core, and I think every session I go to, there's a move sort of away from some of that and more to the natural and nature-based features and figuring out how to incorporate that which nature offers us to deal with some of it. So sort of in your question, there absolutely is a lot of raise and a lot of businesses. I think it speaks to their commitment to stay is really where it's at, is that they're looking to adapt and truly not embracing retreat because of what the region offers. But I would submit that there are opportunities throughout the suite of responses for businesses, for all that, you know, view this as an opportunity. And as we had the Dutch dialogues in Hampton Roads last summer, much of what they're doing revolves around just that. What can we do as we learn to live with the water in this suite of alternatives? And that's, I think, new and sort of novel for even us as the engineers, because most folks in my headquarters and in the resident offices for the Norfolk District are very interested in building something large. That's what we like to do. That's why I love going to a construction site and seeing something large. And so I think we're embracing all of it and doing a better job with the full suite. So in terms of opportunity, I think they're abundant.
Great. Questions? Audience questions.
Hello. Hello?
Wow.
All right.
There you go.
Is everybody awake now? So, good morning. My name is Maggie Fernandez. I'm with Sustainable Miami, and I'm a chamber member. First, I want to thank Mr. Murley for making that great announcement about the Resilient Miami Grant. I just want to give out to all the residents that came out to last year's budget hearing who were influential in creating the Chief Resiliency Officer position and getting the board to create and fund that position. So, gone again? Okay. So props to the residents. So great. So question. This is a business chamber, and we are interested in making money. So my question, and I'm not sure who to direct this to, is when are we going to be able to create a solar in Miami-Dade County?
A solar what?
Economy. When are we going to truly have solar choice so that we could start making money off selling solar and then also, you know, be better to the environment?
Well, fortunately, we have the senior director for FPNL's Clean Energy Office here with us. And Buck, you want to take it?
So first of all, solar already exists. I mean, everybody has the opportunity to put solar on their roof today. So we've got over 3,000 customers that have solar on their roof. The issue with solar is the economics. So when residents begin to realize that it's economically feasible for them to put on the roof, they will. The issue in Florida is that FPL's rates are probably the lowest that they've been in many, many years. Our rates today are actually lower than they were in 2006. So you're paying about 9.1 cents a kilowatt hour. In Los Angeles, for example, California, where they have mandated solar, they're paying 20.5 cents a kilowatt hour. So the issue is you already have that opportunity. We're actually announcing that we're building, as Irene said, we're building three of the largest solar projects in the country. They've already began mobilizing. The project going to come online by the end of 2016. So that's going to basically triple the amount of solar that we already have in our state. But by the same token, in other parts of the state, we're already the largest renewable energy company in the United States. So as we continue to drive the economics of solar, you'll begin to see more and more of that in the grid. So the issue is really the economics. Everything else will take care of itself, and you're seeing a huge decline and precipitous decline in the cost of solar in the last so many years. So you're going to continue to see that that decline. But with natural gas prices being as low as they are, that's what's probably kept the economics of solar, you know, kind of challenged for now, at least in Florida.
Thanks, Buck. I think, Jim, you wanted to add to that?
That recognizing the importance of economics and finance, the county commission has been recognizing this, as have our cities. The cities have been in the lead in setting up PACE programs in along the US 1 corridor and up in the Northeast. But the county commission has also moved forward to make changes in our existing PACE ordinance so that it'll be more available to a greater number of people who reside in unincorporated Dade County. That allows you to finance not only solar but also improvements to your home to make them more resilient to storms. So I think at that level, the pace, the movement, the initiative by the cities and the county following up in the unincorporated area, I think we'll see tools available to individual citizens.
Thank you. Thank you, Maggie. Is there another question? Oh,
I'd like to add to that. I think that that's an important point that Maggie brought up, was the mitigation of greenhouse gas emissions and how we can further increase our energy efficiency. In Miami Beach, we have a number of programs that we're moving forward, including installation of electric vehicle charging stations citywide, so not just in garages, but also on street parking. And as part of that, we're looking to for different programs on how we can reduce personal vehicle use within Miami Beach by providing better transportation options. We've also passed an ordinance recently requiring that all new construction over 7,000 square feet be LEED Gold. And this is a step to create a building stock which is more energy efficient, saves water, and uses materials that are more sustainable. And we're also, like Jim said, looking at PACE financing to provide that to our businesses and residents. So constantly looking how, as a local government, we can help push the bar to reduce greenhouse gas emissions within our community. Thank you.
I think it's also important to emphasize that, you know, government isn't going to come here and resolve this issue. I think this is an individual responsibility that we all have. We can do things in our homes already to lower emissions. We can incorporate, we can work together as a community, and that's something that I think is still, the community's still thinking, well, you know, government's going to come in and save us and tell us what to do or whatever. No, there are a lot of things that we could be doing, and that CO2 issue is definitely part of this conversation. As we're talking about solutions, there are very simple solutions an individual can make and a business can make already to be part of a solution and mitigate the problem. Do we have another question? One more question.
Hello. Mm-hmm. Hi, I'm Camila Alvarez, representing my alma mater, the Rosenstiel School of Marine Sciences here in Key Biscayne, and County Commissioner Xavier Suarez. I'd like to ask the Colonel's Army Corps of Engineers, probably more relevant. Oh, by the way, thank you, Buck. That's very, very encouraging to hear about more safe energy for our, you know, the safety of our drinking water and our safety in general, and increasing storm surges in relation to nuclear energy. I'm very happy to hear there's going to be more solar energy for the economy and everything. But going back to the economy, focusing more on the consumer part of it, which is obviously very important, I believe it's more relevant in Jacksonville than Norfolk, but maybe I'm wrong. What can we, or elected officials and city planners, resilient leaders, et cetera, do to better prepare the middle to low income side of the economy, particularly the houses here? I think I have more friends than not who've worked their whole lives to buy a house and unincorporated date, a pretty nice house, but not exactly to the standards of a lot of their driveways actually go down as it gets closer to the house, and they don't even have any steps going into their house, and they're having problems with flooding already. And I'm sure in the next decade that can become chaos, the amount of people that we have dealing with that. What can we do to better prepare for that?
So it's an important question, so thanks for posing it to all of us. This systems effort that we've all spoken to is part of that. I mean, I'm not here and don't have any insight into small business or housing, the housing authority and those sort of things. There's a federal housing authority, and then there's state and local manifestations of that, and I don't know any of the details from their vantage point. But the systems-based risk assessment is going to help us and have communities be able to help broadly the populace that's out there. So I think that the investment is to make a given jurisdiction. I mean, you have a mayor right in front of you who could tell you, looking at the entire geography of the city, and as Colonel Kelly said, schools. I mentioned the hospital at Mount Sinai. You know, looking at critical infrastructure becomes the enabler for folks, no matter their economic strata, to stay in an area because they have transportation infrastructure that's still supportable, they have hospitals that are still supportable, and so the focus of an agency like the Corps of Engineers is to help prioritize, assess risk with science, and then oftentimes the local leaders can use that information to prioritize their investments to protect that infrastructure. So that's an initial thought. I don't know if that totally gets at your question.
I would like to add to that. I think, for starters, the community certainly can engage us at any time. And that's done with regularity. I know in the district I lead, it's usually done through our chief of planning. But this is a collaborative effort. I mentioned the workshop that I attended with the Rockefeller, led by the Rockefeller Foundation. And there, with myself and our planning team, city manager of Norfolk, the deputy city manager was there, and oftentimes we'd be speaking of things from a federal agency perspective, federal interest, net economic development, the science, and they would, and we also consider some other social factors a part of it. But some of what you described, the manner in which we have these studies, that is all a part of it. It's all in there. So some of the things in terms of what we do impact on a particular region is most certainly considered. But my answer to what you pose and some of the sort of intangibles to what we're doing is a collaborative requirement that we have the right folks and on this study. And then like any other government organization, when I speak to study, it's really getting us to the authorization, which ultimately leads you to compete and have a chance for an appropriation. So the study is the means by which all of what you spoke to and the challenges that accompany such an endeavor would be born and brought to light. And it's from there we'd make our point of origin in terms of what we ought to be doing and how monies ought to be spent. But that's done in collaboration with the non-federal sponsors.
I mean, in the kind of piggybacking on the nature of the collaboration, and that's collaboration needs to go beyond government agencies, yes, and local governments, but also into the private sector, individual property owners, both commercial and residential, because any infrastructural response to the sea level rise and flooding has the probability of failure. You know, if you build it for a 500-year storm, you may get hit by a 1,000-year storm, and it's going to be overtopped and it's going to be breached. And if the real estate community continues to develop behind a seawall with the idea that the Army Corps of Engineers is going to save us from all perils in all instances, if one of these events happens, then the losses will be that much more catastrophic if the individual property owners don't take steps themselves to mitigate their risk. And so that's where, as Albert mentioned, in Norfolk or in Hampton Roads, where they take individual property owners are taking those steps to raise and to come up with solutions and make those investments. I think that's something that we in the real estate community and as the community as a whole, as individuals, need to start embracing. And again, I think the key, getting back to my previous point, is finding innovative ways to align those incentives so every individual property owner can take their own steps to both. So it becomes together. We're working with the government, with the Army Corps of Engineers, and with our public utilities and the like as individuals to make our entire community more resilient.
Thank you. Can I ask that? Sure. This is it. Running out of time.
Okay. It's interesting. I mean, I think it would be interesting to hear some examples of where having enough information to make a decision actually makes a difference. We did a study for the district, the water management district. It's actually still going on. And the point of the study was to discover how much is it going to cost to run their system going out 100 years, year by year by year by year. They, you know, basically their budget to run their $2 billion stormwater system is $50 million a year. And they wanted to know, is that going to be enough? And we created a forecasting system that added it all up. And it showed that $50 million will be great until 2050, at which point they will need something like $200 million in 2051 or something like that. Because essentially all of their structures were installed at around the same time. And so they're all going to hit lifespan right around then. So we then, you know, improved our model and looked at ways to make it more efficient and spread that cost out and came up with an answer that was, you know, $50 million now. If we push that to $60 million and proactively work on the system up until 2050, we're going to cut the cost down and keep it efficient. That information went to the board at the district and influenced the decision that the board made about revenue generation. That's an example, I think, of a systems-based analysis generating information that actually results in a decision that gets us out of trouble in the future. And I think that that's really the approach we have to take in order to avoid problems like the ones that you're describing.
That's a great example of government taking proactive responsibility. And that's a very old system that wasn't even built to sustain the population that we have today. So I'm glad that, you know, the board is moving forward. With that, I'm sure many of you will be around. I think, except Colonel Kirk, you gotta go. But if you have any questions, please feel free to approach our panelists. I wanna thank all of you. It's so informative. We could be here like for another 2 days, but I really appreciate the time and all the projects that you're working on and everything you're doing for the communities that you're in and our community as well. So thank you very much. What we're going to do now is we're going to take a short break. When we come back, we're going to do something, you know, interesting and interactive and fun. We're actually going to engage in table conversations and start prioritizing some of the county's areas of focus. What we'd like to do is look at this list of areas of focus for resiliency and adaptation and rank what are the top three areas that the county should be focusing like right now, whether it's moving Everglades restoration forward, whether it's, you know, changing our building codes, whether it's lowering emissions. So I'm going to give instructions when we get back, but that's what we'd like to do. And that will be the that will be the information that our chamber will use to speak as a unified business entity, as far as this is where we feel, the business community feels, we need to be with regards to planning for storm readiness and sea level rise. So thank you.
We're going to take a short break.